you will see progress in your own personal life.
Beautiful.
And you will feel so much blissful every day.
And I think that's evident here. We've had that experience, that taste.
Yeah.
Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Om Nityananda Paramashivoham.
Nityanandam Paramasukadam Kevalam Jnanamurtim Dvandvatitam Gaganasadrusham Tatvamasyadilakshyam Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadi Sakshibhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami.
Nityananda, everybody, and welcome to another session of the Guru Gita Revealed by Sri Charana, and I'm his fellow host, Sri Nithya Dridananda. Thank you so much for being here. Today's our second session discussing the Guru Gita, one of the most auspicious texts on the planet, you could say, as far as liberation, enlightenment goes. And one thing that we covered a little bit yesterday was an introduction to the Guru Gita, what it is, and I just kind of want to re-discuss one little aspect, which is where we kind of ended off as well, Kailasa. Yes. We hear our Guru Bhagavan Sri Nityananda Paramashivam speak on Kailasa continuously, saying that he's in Kailasa, that we can all reach Kailasa. And even in the Guru Gita, it's revealed Shiva's describing what Kailasa looks like.
Yeah.
And so we're seeing this physical place as well, but maybe you can elaborate on what Kailasa
actually,
is.
Actually, in the Hindu Puranas, Vishnu will live in Vaikuntha, and in the Shiva will be staying in the Kailasha, which is described in the mountains of Himalayas,
so
completely covered with snow, and he will be doing penance there. That is a Kailasha. That is a description in Puranas.
In the physical realm. Okay, and then so to reach Kailasa, when Swamiji is speaking on reaching Kailasa and being in that space.
So it is like reaching Kailasa means attaining the Shivatva, that I am Sivoham, experiencing that state of Shivatva and in a higher conscious level.
Okay.
Reaching to the higher conscious level and understanding Shivatattva.
So,
and we used to use the word Shivoham means I am Shiva, Shiva I am. And establishing oneness with that Paramashiva, that will give the space of Kailasa.
Beautiful. Yes. So could we say that Kailasa is like a synonym for enlightenment or moksha?
It is a world of Shiva. Shiva is all auspiciousness. It is a world of the higher consciousness and supreme God of this thing.
Okay, and that's the goal of life, is to reach that world of Shiva, Kailasa itself.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, as a human birth, we have taken all species, human beings are more, all the species available on planet Earth, humans have the possibility of getting liberation.
Yes.
So we crossed different births, like we born as animals, flies, everything. And now we come to a state where the realization will make us Shiva.
Yeah.
So that is a very few, rarest people who will try it exactly seeks that. It's called in action moksha or a liberation or attaining the higher state of consciousness.
Mm. So if you're watching...
It's all different words they use.
So if you're watching this right now, there's a good chance that you've lived hundreds, maybe thousands of births, taking different forms, whether insect, rock, animal, human, and you've come to a point where you're now listening to the sacred words of the Guru Gita, which is the secret key to your liberation, your moksha. You're reaching this Kailasa state. Beautiful.
Yes.
And so with that, we'll dive into our next verses. We ended last session on verse 17. Yes. I think the beauty of Guru Gita is you don't necessarily need to read it one verse followed by another. You can jump in at certain points
something. If you understand the Sanskrit thing, every lot of very important phrases are there, which gives a deeper understanding about.
Certainly.
You see, the whole thing is the importance of Guru. Guru means a two-letter word, how powerful it is, how the whole human beings can really see the solutions for all their things and get liberated. This that is Guru, that is two words. Everything is explained in a detailed way in this thing.
Beautiful. Himself. So let's dive into, we're at verse 18.
Yeah.
Maybe you can chant the first, or verse 18 for us.
Yeah. मम रूपासि देवी त्वमस्तस्य कदामि ते लोकोपकारक प्रश्नो न केनापि कृतः पुरा.
So this is to the translation. This is Shiva speaking to Devi, correct?
Yes.
He's saying, O Devi, you are none other than my own self. Therefore, I will recount it to you. A question of this kind, which can benefit the entire world, has never been asked by anyone before. So Devi was, just to give a prelude of saying the question that she had asked, her along with the Saptarishis, various different masters, enlightened beings themselves, are inquiring to what is the purpose of Guru. Can you sing the Guru Gita to us? And they've asked in various different ways.
Yes,
and so now Shiva's finally going to reveal this to us.
Yes. And another important thing in this wordings is the Mama Rupasi Devi means you are like my form. Or you, he's telling the status of the Devi. In the whole world, Devi is the oldest, the greatest devotee of Shiva. And so Shiva, we do use Shiva means Devi. So that way she is attained to the equal state of his. He's a so devoted. She's equal to Shiva. And but Shiva himself found his greatest devotee asking this question and developed a lot of enthusiasm to explain.
Super.
So that way he says that use Mama Rupasi Devi. That is, and you are asking for the benefit of the whole world. Lokopakarakaha prasnoha. These sort of questions are really pertinent, useful for the whole world. You are asking that. I'm going to answer to that.
And this transfers across time and space, right? This is not just benefit at that time. It's benefit today, this question that Devi has asked.
Yes.
Beautiful. Yeah. So let's move on to the next verse, verse 19.
यस्य देवे परा भक्तिर यथा देवे तथा गुरु तस्यैते खदिता ह्यार्दः प्रकाशन्ते महात्मनः.
One who has complete devotion towards the Lord and has a similar kind of devotion towards the Guru, he alone can understand the truths explained here.
Yes. See, here there is no difference between the God, the Lord, and the Guru. That's what he wants to emphasize.
Yeah.
So those who have correct understanding, they had established oneness as they have oneness with God, with the Guru, they are the right devotees, or they are right matured status. That is what he's explaining. This.
And I almost want to keep count of how many times Shiva says the equal state of Guru is Shiva. Shiva is Guru.
Yes,
he
says
this continuously throughout the Guru Gita, and this is the first time that he's mentioned this.
Yeah, the next statement, next thing also is like that.
Yo
Guru sa Shiva prokto, yas Shiva sa Guru smrutaha, vikalpam yastu kurvita.
The scriptures assert that the Guru is none other than Shiva, and Shiva is none other than the Guru. Hence, one who differentiates between the Guru and Shiva is a Guru Talpaga.
Yeah, Guru, they are mistaken completely. There is no difference, actually. They are still to have to attain the maturity that they are still finding a difference between Shiva and Guru. But he says that they are equal in all aspects.
And this is, I think, maybe a part of the karmic pattern in the Western world, the difficulty of seeing somebody that seems to be a human being as God.
Yes,
that's just completely illogical to so many people in the West. And
and
even in the Kulārṇava Tantra, it says that those that see the Guru as a human being, they do so because of their bad karma.
Yes, yes.
But those that see Guru as Shiva, they do so because of his good karma.
Yes, yes.
And so,
actually, the Guru is a walking God on planet Earth.
Yes.
That is a thing. that they, if you have connection to the Guru, you will see, suppose you are a devotee of Krishna, you will see Krishna in him.
Mm.
And if you are a devotee of, there is a lot of examples, if you read the histories of Guru Charitras, or different lineages, like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Vivekananda, or Sai Baba, those gurus, their devotees saw their divine in their guru.
Mm.
Suppose he is Shiva Bhakta, he will see his guru as Shiva. Mm. Like that. There are a lot of examples like that. So that way, there is no difference. If you are different, then there's something wrong with your understanding. That is what you...
So if you're maybe you're not from the West, but you have this logical mindset where it's difficult for you to see God in human form, that is definitely a thought current that needs to be worked away at, because obviously for you and I, we've experienced that in our guru, Bhagavan.
Yes.
And so many other beings have experienced that with their guru as well.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you can maybe say to somebody out there that has difficulty in seeing?
Actually, Swamiji himself told in many of the satsangs that the Guru Tattva is there. The Guru Tattva is the one. Swami has also Guru. Even Krishna has Guru.
Yes.
And Rama is having Guru. So the Guru Tattva is so higher, this thing. We are just garlanding one personality, means his Guru Tattva. What is compassion, his shivatva, whatever he is exhibiting through his deeds and his thing, for that we are garlanding, or for that we are worshipping.
Mm.
As long as you are connected to the higher Guru Tattva and remove all the other obstacles from you, you'll be in a bliss.
And even Shiva himself, we learned in yesterday's verses that he was praying to some other being beyond himself.
Yes, he's a guru. That Guru Tattva, that's what he is explaining in these words.
But even the Lord of Lords is doing that.
He says that as a guru, in anybody's person in their lifestyle, if you find him as a guru, that Guru Tattva is. He's explaining that Guru Tattva.
Beautiful. So maybe we can lead into that. That's the next verse.
Dullabham trishu lokeshu tachrunashva padam yaham guru brahma vina nanya satyam satyam varanane.
O beautiful faced one, listen to me. I declare to you that obtaining a guru who is none other than the Brahman is the rarest phenomenon in all the three worlds. This is the truth. This is the truth. This is the truth.
Yes. Actually, I'm recollecting one great book called Viveka Chudamani, written by the Shankaracharya.
Mm.
In that, third sloka or something, he says that in all these things, durlabham manushyatvam, this is our very rare things, to attain the manushyatvam, means getting a human body, and mumukshatvam, that's true seeking, inside in the personalities, true seeking, and to getting entangled with the enlightened master.
Mm.
That is very rarest.
Mm.
There is a beautiful sloka is there in that says that.
Ah.
So this is the rare. That's what he's using this here. Very rare, durlabham. In all these worlds, it is very rare to getting entangled and finding an enlightened master.
So why is it so rare? Can you speak on that?
No, the thing is that crowds of people will go on to the temples and go around it.
Yeah.
And out of, actually Swamiji gave another talk about, based on their purva karmas, they are completely entangled with the desires. And one desire is fulfilled, the fulfilled desire becomes small, and the desire which is not fulfilled looks like a big mountain. Like it goes on, but they never comes to a desireless state or a state of maturity or something.
Mm.
But that is a state of that person.
Mm.
So it will go on, like it will go on for janmas.
Mm.
And very few will realize the some japa they will do.
Mm.
In some situations they will do little mature, go do and do meditation, and then go to a master and surrender to him. And these are the rarest things. Swamiji gave in the talk, probably we can, I'll quote later on the talk of Swamiji, how he explains that the Guru will show you the Atma Tattva, and your Daiva Bhakti will change to Guru Bhakti, and Guru will give you liberation by giving the Atma Bhakti.
Beautiful.
That is a beautiful thing, Swamiji.
Beautiful. And so one other thing I just want to touch on, the three worlds, all the three worlds. Yes. What are the three worlds that Shiva is referring to here?
Trishu Lokeshu means they are... they can be inner world, outer world, inner world, or even a spiritual world.
Okay.
Different way we can define that one.
Okay.
Like a dream state or waking state or deep sleep state.
Okay.
And different states, different ways.
Okay.
So he said three worlds through which you you can't find this sort of things.
So in one satsang, Swamiji spoke on the word three, and it wasn't necessarily meaning just three. It was in Sanskrit, if it's three, it's anything beyond three.
Yes.
Is that the word that's being used here?
No, this one says Trishu Lokeshu only.
Trishu Lokeshu?
Yes,
okay.
Yes, okay. Next, we move to the next thing. Veda Shastra Puranani Chetihasani Kanicha Mantra Yantradi Vidyanam Mohanocharnadikam.
Can you read on to 23 as well?
Yeah. Shaiva Shakta Gamadini Hyanyecha Bahuno Mataha Apabhramshaha Samastanam Jivanam Bhranta Chetasam.
So the translation is studying the Vedas, Shastras, Puranas, and the Itihasas, learning the mantras, worshipping the yantras, obtaining supernatural powers, and following various sects like Shaivism, Shaktism, etc., will delude all the beings with a perplexed mind.
So there, many people will think that everything is in books. If you read a lot of books, keep on a book bug sort of thing, keep on going around the libraries. This will help them, or they are not knowledge. Their knowledge will come through books. That is thing. But there is all, it will add delusion to you than clearing it.
Okay.
So that's why he is telling that this is not equivalent to approaching a guru or having an enlightened master.
Okay. I kind of see that as like building the body. You can read as many books as you want on yoga, but unless you actually start practicing, like Patanjali says himself, then you're not going to build the body.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the yantras, worshipping the yantras.
Yeah, there are a lot of methods. Like he says, they get a Veda Shastra Purana. Purana means the stories of the different gods, Veda Shastras, and mantra, repeating a lot of mantras and worshipping the designs, like yantras. There are different approaches to the people will adopt to find the actual solution, seeking.
Okay.
They're seeking. But it is once it is matured or to come to the higher states, Swamiji, you'll approach an enlightened master, and guru is so important.
Okay.
At that time.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Maybe we can just jump right away to verse 24.
Yeah. Japastapo vratam tirtham yikno danam tadhaivacha guru tattva mavignaya sarva vyattham bhavet priye. Means it is doing japa. Doing vratas, like fasting or doing vratas, and going to a different pilgrim places, tirtham, and doing quite a lot of homas, and giving dana, like giving away a lot of money and doing it. All these things are waste unless you understand Guru Tattva. That is simply he used the word.
Wow.
All waste without understanding Guru Tattva.
Wow.
So I say, Guru Tattva Mavignaya, without knowing Guru Tattva, all these things are useless.
The essence of the Supreme Truth. These are useless unless you understand that.
I understand. Yes. See, the thing is, many situations, Guru has attained a state of enlightenment, and he is like a big repository of all the experiences versus all the repository. He is a God himself. And he knows what is your path, where from you are approaching. Probably he may guide you to read this book and understand. And a lot of examples are in most of the Guru Charitras, if you listen to it. The Guru will ask him to go and read this book and come back. And go and talk to this person, you will get some revelation. But if you are under his guidance and Guru walk, if you follow, you will be better guided. You will see progress in your own personal life.
Beautiful.
And you'll feel so much blissful every day.
I think that's evident here. We've had that experience, that taste.
Yeah.
The Guru Tattva is real in the Nityananda Sangha.
Yes.
verse 25.
Okay. Guru Buddhatmanyo Nanyat Satyam Satyam Varanane Tallabhardam Prayatnastu Kartavyascha Manishibihi.
O beautiful faced one, Guru Buddhi, which is the supreme truth, is nothing but the realization of one's true self.
Yeah.
This is the truth. Hence, a seeker should make sincere efforts to attain this wisdom.
Yeah. Actually, in one other dimension, people, we have to understand this, that guru, you are your own guru, like the inner guru. So the external guru will try to invoke that inner guru in you.
Mm.
And when inner guru is invoked, there won't be any dual talk. You will simply follow the thing, and they won't be, you will be feel so bliss that there is no inner chatter will go down.
Uh-huh.
That dual thing will go down, and uh-huh. you'll completely surrender to the guru, and you will be, your approach will be out of complete gratitude.
Mm.
And you worship outer we do, as we do the Guru Puja every day.
Yeah.
We enjoy the being intimate with the presence of the, we invoke this the guru in our presence.
Mm.
And we do puja.
Mm.
That connection will invoke your inner guru also.
Mm.
And your life will be so blissful.
Yeah.
So that is this says that you have realized that inner guru will be evoked slowly.
Mm. And just on that note, the Guru Puja that we do offer, that is something that's available any day to
yes.
everybody. And
yes.
along with that, learning how to chant the mantras to go
yes.
along with this puja,
yes, yes,
that's
yes.
available to learn freely here
yes.
at
yeah.
Kailasa in L.A., Nityanandeshwar.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm conducting Zoom sessions and teaching people how to chant and do. How to sit before it, how to arrange puja kit and do the external work.
Yeah.
See, as Swamiji usually beautifully says, as long as you identify yourself with a form, you should have a form to which you have to worship and do practices.
Mm.
So that way we found the Swamiji is the embodiment of Sarva Deva Deva Swarupa.
Mm.
So we will just invite him and do the puja with complete gratitude.
Mm.
That is a practice that make you so intimate with your guru.
So
and yeah.
So with this context,
yes.
I've heard a lot of people in the West say that they are their own guru. So when they hear me speak about my guru and whatnot, and they say they are their own guru, and I say yes, this is true to a certain extent.
Yeah.
How would you respond to them? Being that they don't have a physical guru,
yeah, yeah.
they say that they're their own guru right away.
The thing is, we don't know many situations whether your ego is talking or you are talking.
Yeah.
And if that is true, if you I'm your own guru, you should not face any sort of up and downs in your life.
Mm.
Like you should not feel sorrow. You should be always blissful.
Yeah.
Always blissful, it is, can you say that?
Yeah.
If you are really always blissful like Nityananda.
Yeah.
See, the word Nityananda is always eternally blissful.
Yes, yes.
So you are Nityananda, you know. Always eternally blissful.
So
if you are eternally blissful, that also, by seeing outside the blissful, this thing, you'll also become more blissful, suddenly.
Yeah.
So that way, coming to the master and listening to him, will certainly enhances your spiritual growth.
Mm, beautiful.
Yes.
Beautiful. We can jump into verse 26.
Ghoda vidya jagan maya deha chajnana sambhavah vijnanam tat prasadena guru shabdena kathayate.
The world is maya, which is sheer ignorance. This body is born out of ignorance, by whose grace one attains this supreme wisdom. That source of grace is referred to by the term guru.
Yes, that is where the word guru, actually I'm telling in a few minutes back about what is the word guru means. There are a lot of definitions in this, how it is interpreted.
Mm.
Guru means
mm.
you have crossed a lot of births with a lot of delusions and ajnana. And Guru is a personality who will take you out of your Janma Karma, or the cycle of births and thing, and he will liberate you.
Mm.
So once you find the Guru, that is you are almost getting liberated from this birth and death cycle.
Mm.
So that is one way. And many way he will pour knowledge into you and pour bliss into you.
Mm.
And you will and see to you that his followers or his disciples will get and state what he's enjoying.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And so just to touch on the word Maya itself,
yes.
Yeah. The world is Maya, which is sheer ignorance. Even if you feel happiness, Swamiji says that itself is delusion as well.
Yes.
Or illusion, and sadness or depression is delusion.
Yeah, there is an opposite to happiness, like the sorrowfulness and sad, depressed state.
Mm.
But for bliss, there's no opposite.
Yeah.
This is a state you have to experience. Mm. That is what ananda.
Yes.
The Sanskrit word is ananda.
And I think that's what really separates Swamiji from other self-development gurus or other gurus that speak on living happily and experiencing that happiness.
Yes.
Swamiji is just direct to the point.
Yeah.
It's you're eternal or blissful. That's your true state.
Yes. And of course, Swamiji used to say that I am here to say, prove not I am God, but you are God.
Exactly.
So you are also a blissful personality.
Yes.
Who are came.
And like, Shiva is saying here, until you cross that ignorance.
Yes.
And you cut through that Maya.
Yes.
You're caught in that world of delusion, right?
Yes.
And it's the Guru that he's that source of grace for you.
Grace. Mm. Yes.
Verse 27.
इदं गृकमलं द्वंद्वं द्वंद्वातप निवारकं तारकं भवसिन्धोश्च तं गुरुं प्रणमाम्यहम्.
I prostrate to the Guru whose lotus feet remove the sufferings arising from the dualities of life, such as likes and dislikes, good and bad, etc., and help man cross the ocean of samsara.
Yes. Shiva means always auspiciousness.
Mm.
You become, we have to say that in most of the verses we say Shivoham, Shivoham. Mm. Means I am auspiciousness.
Mm.
And everything is auspicious to me.
Mm.
So that is Shiva Tattva, or Shiva is Shiva's state of space.
Mm.
So to attain that, that is what it says that you have crossed that bad and bad worst or good, bad, everything, and you are in a state of thinking equally, both of them, like that. Yeah.
So this is the first time that the words lotus feet is brought up as well.
Yes.
So for somebody in the West, like I grew up, and to see somebody worship another person's feet, it's a real, like a strange approach to worship, in a sense. So, why is that?
Swamiji told this, that the most worshipable, in one of the slokas, he says, most worshipable is the Guru's feet. That like if you find a personality to whom you want to pour your love, the best thing you touch in his body, not his head or not his hand, touch the feet. That is the Shastra says. That is the connection you develop. That way, Guru Padukas and Guru Paduka worship is very relevant.
As you can see here, there are Guru Padukas behind us, Swamiji's Padukas, his sandals.
Yes.
They are energized with the feet of the master, the lotus feet, as Shiva is describing here.
Yeah. You simply feel connected to them. That is like once you have pouring your devotion to him, remembering his feet and his grace, whoever come under touch his feet, he will be blessed with his this thing. See, even Krishna, Shiva are all Hindu gods. They'll bless their devotees who touches the feet of the thing. Feet is the most attracting thing for a devotee.
It's really interesting, because even my Sakshi Pramana, my own personal experience, if I see Swamiji in the physical body and I'm given the opportunity, I would literally fall at his feet, just natural instinct now, wanting to touch and almost just like hug his feet.
It's
a beautiful experience to have. It's like being in Kailasa itself. So maybe we'll go one more verse and we'll end it for today's session.
Okay. देहि ब्रह्म भवेद्यस्मात् तत्कृपार्थं वदामि तत् सर्वपापविशुद्धात्मा श्रीगुरोः पादसेवनात्. Again, came to the पादसेवनात्.
Yes. Yeah. And even the next line, maybe read the next line as well. It does mention that.
सर्वतीर्थावगाहस्य सम्प्राप्नोति फलं नरः गुरोः पादोदकं पीत्वा शेषं शिरसि धारयन्.
So Shiva is speaking, saying, only by rendering service unto the auspicious feet of the Guru, man is liberated from the consequences of all his misdeeds and attains the state of Brahman. I bestow upon you my grace by revealing this secret to you. And then he says, just by drinking the water obtained from washing the holy feet of the Guru, and by sprinkling the remaining water on the head, man obtains the fruit of bathing in all the sacred rivers.
Yes.
So, yeah. Obviously, Shiva is speaking very heavily on the feet of Guru. He continues to state that.
Yes.
And it's bestowing a grace, revealing this, or I bestow upon you my grace by revealing this secret to you. So this is a very important secret of life, he's saying.
Yes.
That the guru, the master's feet,
yes.
is a source of liberation.
Yes.
And when water is touching that, and it's you're experiencing achmaniyam, the sacred bath through it,
yes.
that is a source of your liberation as well.
Yeah. This is a action of with the complete gratitude to the higher consciousness, how you are connected, the guru to whom you are connected.
Mm.
See, if you, that is where they put the way of Guru Padukas or worship, and you visualize that. You see, when you are doing the Guru Puja, you will do visualizing the presence of the guru in front of you.
Mm.
And with complete devotion, you pour water as if you are visualizing that you are cleansing his feet.
Yeah.
And feeling his presence there for all through the puja.
Mm.
In the last, we'll take that padukas and drink that this thing.
Mm.
So that way, you are soaked in gratitude.
Mm.
It's soaked with love.
Mm.
That is the probably love is the more powerful word.
Mm, yeah.
Soaked with love to the master who is available to you and trying to guide you to a higher consciousness.
And even science is starting to understand this as well.
Yes.
I don't know if you know about Dr. Masaru Emoto and his study on the structural of water.
Oh.
When he tested, he would shout and scream at one sample of water, and then he would give his love and gratitude to another and a few other waters. And literally after freezing the water, the cup that was showered with love, it had these beautiful geometric
design. Yes, it's scientifically put on.
Yeah,
yes.
And so that space of gratitude, that is stored in the water itself.
Yes,
and
yes.
The ultimate gratitude that one can have is towards Guru.
Yes, yes.
And so you can really experience that alchemical process
from
doing puja every morning yourself. And,
yes.
and just like we mentioned,
when
you offer puja, you're offering to the padukas of Swamiji, of the master himself.
And sprinkling that same water, you take the teertham and the remaining water you sprinkle on your head.
Yeah.
So that your bioenergy and your thing will be filled with the gratitude, bliss.
Mm.
And the guru's grace will fall upon.
And then along with that, the Sanskrit mantras that get chanted.
Yes.
There
is
science as well.
Like
it's not just some random words that are splurred out. They have a certain frequency vibration to them.
Yes, yes, certainly.
And so
actually, in coming slokas, that explanation also there. How which way it will treat you. Which way you will feel blessed. By taking the teertham from the guru, this thing. That is in next slokas.
Beautiful. And so we'll get to the next slokas maybe next session.
Yeah.
But right now this is all theory, and I totally understand somebody that's watching this that this is just a theory and it doesn't have tangible experience. Have an experience. That I always tell people, don't listen to a word I say. Like experiment yourself, seek yourself. And and there's opportunities here at the temple for those that are interested. As we mentioned, they can take part in your puja classes, your chanting classes, to have this experience of what it means to be soaked in that divine grace.
Yeah, another important thing is Swamiji, out of his grace for the humanity, out of love, he's conducting a lot of programs, and I recommend everybody to sit before Swamiji and experience it, and see, experience. That is what, in my personal thing also, I sat with all the, I saw all the Swamiji's videos, and I sat with him in many of the sessions.
Mm.
That the love connection will happen automatically by that way.
Yeah.
And I recommend all the people to attend this Paramashivoham.
Absolutely. Yeah, and to get the ultimate experience of the connection with Guru,
yeah.
Paramashivoham, go to paramashivoham.org. We'll put that link in the description as well.
Yeah.
That's going directly to the source and experiencing Kailasa.
We have very poor words to explain it, to be frank. We can't explain the joy, that bliss you experience by sitting in front of the Swami.
Exactly.
It's like avyakta. It is not expressible, actually.
Ah, yeah.
So that way you first experience. That's what we recommend you.
Absolutely. And so we'll end this session here today. Again, if you enjoyed this, we'll be going, continue onward. What verse did we get to today? What was that, 29 or so? Yeah, verse 29.
Yes.
And so we definitely do encourage you to come back, and we'll be sharing the remaining verses of the Guru Gita.
Yes.
And hopefully give you an experience as well through some of these programs that you can find in the description below.
Okay.
So thank you again, Sri Charana.
Okay.
And we'll close with the Purna Mantra.
Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Tat Sat Sarvam Bhagavat Sri Nityananda Paramashiva Paduka Paramastu Om Nityanandam.